What's up, guys? Welcome back. So day three of Oppenheimer celebration. Getting you guys ready for the new Oppenheimer movie. Comes out July 20th. Today I opted in for the John Wick look. So look, you know, you guys seen the new one yet? Fucking awesome. Anyway, let's get into this, shall we? My name's Dylan. I just put a PhD in physics on hold to create some fun things. One of those things, my AI project, AIMyInterior.com, is out now. You can use it for free without you don't need a credit card. And you just take a picture of your room, your living room, you upload it to my site, and you can turn it into any interior design style you want. Also about to drop AI My Cars on you guys like a nuclear bomb, and you'll be able to turn your car into a muscle car, supercar in a few seconds. So thank you to everyone who's already come and used it. Really appreciate you guys. I'm loving seeing all the new. It's so funny seeing everyone's rooms on there. It's great. When we implement the subscription as well as the credit system on AIMyInterior.com, there'll be a private space so you won't have to put your room, you know, in public. So today we're just going to watch the Castle Bravo nuclear test explosion. It's quite tragic. There was a lot of international ramifications. There was a lot of really shitty things that happened. So we'll talk a little bit about that. All right, let's check out Castle Bravo. Hydrogen bomb. This is where it's gonna get wild. I mean, that was already wild, right? But you know, these are like 1,000 times more powerful, these things. Another little fun fact: in the sun, same amount of energy as 15 billion of these bombs is produced each second. So the Castle Bravo test bomb's yield was actually 3 times greater than their initial estimates during some oversights during the design process, right? And so it was roughly 1,000 times more powerful than, you know, the nukes dropped on Japan, sadly. And because of such, it became probably the worst, I'm pretty sure it is the worst nuclear disaster. Yeah, bomb disaster, that is. Okay, this is kind of terrifying now. You can't see it in this video, but it also destroyed one island and left this huge crater in it. There's even pictures of it. The last one just looks cute compared to that. Did you guys know that the US has lost 3 nuclear bombs? Yeah, they just lost them. Literally have no idea where they are still to this day. If you want me to make a video on this, because this is also a long sort of winded topic, I could. It could be fun as well. So let me know down under if you want to see that. It might sound wild. Like, how the hell do you lose a nuclear bomb? You know, you just left it at the gym or something. You just forgot it. So these things, I guess, are just lying around somewhere in someone's swamp. It sounds crazy. But remember, like, Russia has, you know, at one time, they had like 45,000 nuclear bombs. I mean, I guess it could be easy to lose one. We know they've lost some as well. I think they actually know where they are, though. You know, they're generally at the bottom of the ocean. Submarines have dropped them or something. But for countries like the UK or France, we have no idea if they've ever misplaced nuclear weapons. The original forecast also predicted that the winds would blow the fallout away from these populated areas. And it did just the opposite. Horrifically, it blew the winds of the fallout, the radioactive fallout, over, you know, 7,000 square miles, some of which were inhabited. And literally just hours later, some of the, you know, people living there handled the fallout with their bare hands. There was huge international outrage over this test, rightly so. And they attempted to reduce the exposure of, like, they increased the exclusion zone. It actually caused huge problems, for instance, for the Japanese fishing industry. And I think America agreed to pay something like $15 million at the time to compensate. And because of this bomb, it inspired the Soviets to actually go bigger as well. And the Castle Bravo explosion wasn't the last test, you know, to be performed in Bikini Atoll. From 46 to 58, they carried out something like 67 atmospheric tests in the area. And we watched one of those, you know, in the previous video. And then in 63, the US signed a limited ban, you know, that prohibited testing nukes in the atmosphere. By the way, guys, mushroom clouds aren't only produced by nukes. If you have a large enough bomb and you blow it up on the ground, you will produce a mushroom cloud. If you don't believe me, there was a bomb set off in Texas, I believe, in 2013 or something, and it produced a mushroom cloud. I think everyone got kind of scared. But yeah, it's pretty normal. I think it was like a 2,000-pound bomb. The physics in all cases are the same. And if you ask a physicist about this phenomena, they'll probably talk about the Rayleigh-Taylor instability. It just describes the interaction between two materials, fluids or gases, at different densities when they are forced together, basically. So if you're interested in this sort of stuff, go Google Rayleigh-Taylor instability. And if you watched my last video, you'd know that just a couple PhDs in physics is able to design one of these things in literally 2.5 years it took them in a big secret test America tried to conduct to see if, you know, other countries could build these things without knowing the secrets, because there are still some secrets, but the physics is there, right? And so these two guys, they didn't have any real knowledge of how to build atomic bombs. They knew you just need to bring some fissile material together. They did it. In 2.5 years, they had designed one. They were told that if, you know, it was built, it would have made a bang similar to Hiroshima. Now, you know, hydrogen bombs, a little more intense. Yeah. It's really insane. So the sun shines because it's able to convert energy from gravity into light, right? And you might be asking, how the hell does it do that? Well, imagine being at the center of the sun, right? A huge amount of mass is above you, squeezing down on you from all sides. This is what happens to the hydrogen gas in the core of the sun. So it gets squeezed together so tightly that 4 hydrogen nuclei combine to form 1 helium atom. And this is called nuclear fusion. In the process, some of the mass of the hydrogen atoms is converted into energy in the form of light. The same process occurs in thermonuclear fusion bombs. In the sun, the process occurs in a controlled manner, obviously. In a bomb, it happens all at once in a big chain reaction explosion. What we just watched is, you could see the fireball created by the largest thermonuclear bomb ever exploded by the United States. It was insanely destructive. Apparently, it produced a crater like a mile wide, 6,500, like 10 feet, and 250 feet deep. The sun doesn't blow to pieces, though, because of the tremendous weight of the gas above. It's like this constant balance. It exactly balances the pressure from all the energy produced. But if the fusion rate would go down so that less energy was produced in the sun's core, then gravity would cause the sun to start collapsing. Thanks for watching, guys. Make sure you come check out AIMyInterior.com. You can use it for free, no credit card. Make sure you subscribe. Come back tomorrow because there'll be another video celebrating, you know, the release of Oppenheimer on July 20th. So make sure you come back because I know how nukes work and I know where you live.